Good afternoon, everybody. So over the next 22 minutes, I will be talking about the management protocol of COVID-19. Yeah, so this is what the outline of my study is going to be. I'm going to talk about the severity classification before delving into the algorithms for addressing mild, moderate, and severe COVID-19. And I would be also talking about the different pharmacotherapies. And I will be taking the help of a few case vignettes to drive home my points. Right. So the management of COVID-19 should start with a little clarity about the severity classification of COVID-19. So COVID-19, probably, you know, this is going to be a repetition for some or all of you. I think it would serve the purpose of this seminar well if we have comprehensive discussion. So please bear with me if some of this appears to be a repetition to you. So COVID-19, can we classify it into mild, moderate, and severe? Mild, we know that the patient is having fever and or uncomplicated respiratory tract infection. But otherwise, there is no complaint of dyspnea. There's no hypoxemia. His respiratory rate is fine. Moderate is when the saturation hovers between 90 to 94% on room air, or the respiratory rate hovers between 24 to 30 on room air. And the severe is when the patient saturation drops below 90%, or the respiratory rate moves above 30 per minute. Then that is when we classify it as severe COVID-19. Right. So a patient who has been diagnosed to be COVID positive. So if you just look at the chart here, so briefly we can classify them as asymptomatic or symptomatic. So asymptomatic patients, usually they require home isolation. For symptomatic patients, we can classify them according to the protocol which we had just seen, mild, moderate, and severe. Now, mild patients without any comorbidities, they are at low risk for progression to severe disease. So they can also be monitored at home. They can also be home isolated. Mild disease with comorbidities, as also moderate disease and severe disease, they need to be hospitalized. Now for all these hospitalized patients, so there's some treatment protocol, including a battery of investigations, some management. So we are going to talk about all these in the subsequent slides. Right. So if I'm allowed to give a bird's eye view about the management of COVID-19 in a single slide. So this is how it is going to be. So mild disease, who all are cared at home, ideally they should not receive any form of investigations. So ideally no imaging, no blood investigations are required. All that is required is symptomatic treatment and monitoring. There may be a probable role of inhaled budesonide as per some of the recent trials which have been published, and we are going to talk about it. For moderate and severe disease, as also patients of mild disease who have been admitted to COVID hospital, they require some investigations. And out of this moderate and severe disease, they also require some pharmacotherapy and other therapies. So you know, a childish mnemonic which is often used is that of road or toad, where OAD stands for oxygen, anticoagulations, and dexamethasone. So, you know, puerile or childish as this mnemonic is, I think it serves the purpose well when it stresses that OAD as well as remdesivir and tocilizumab, they are only indicated in moderate to severe disease. They're not indicated in mild disease patients at all. And out of this, the sheath anchored or the main points or the foundation of the therapy is constituted by oxygen, anticoagulation, dexamethasone, while the role of remdesivir and tocilizumab, they are more limited. So we are going to talk about this, right? So let us start with this, you know, case vignette one. This is about Mr. X, a 35-year-old male who has called you saying that he has been recently diagnosed COVID positive, mild symptoms, and he is day 5 into his illness. So this is one of the several phone calls that you perhaps receive during the day. And he says that he has already talked to some friends and relatives, and he has also Googled about his symptoms. So what he wanted to know is very specific. He wanted to know that when can he get his inflammatory markers done. He knows about its CRP, IL-6, ferritin. He also wants to know when should his first CT scan be planned, since he has, since you know, he is already into his day 5, day 6 of illness. And he has been started by started on steroids by a well-wisher. Now that he's continuing to have mild symptoms of fever, etc., should he be increasing the dose of methylprednisolone? So that is what his questions are. So in order to understand that, let us just look at the management of mild disease. So mild disease, all the protocols, be it CDC, WHO, IDSA, or even the AIMS protocol, they say that mild disease who are not hospitalized, there's no role of routine blood investigations. There is also no role of doing routine CT scans in all patients. So what is required is essentially symptomatic treatment is required. In the protocol, there's mention of ivermectin, and some people also give zinc, vitamin C. But however, these are soft points. There are no evidence till now prove that they have they change the course or they lead to earlier improvement in patients of mild COVID-19, but still they are used, probably because of the belief that they are innocuous at best. Even if they are not producing much benefit, they are probably not causing much harm either. As per two recent trials, STOIC trial and principal trial, there has been some debate about the use of inhaled budesonide. It has been seen that inhaled budesonide, especially when it is used for high-risk patients in the dose of 1600 microgram per day, for 5 to 7 days, it has been seen that they might reduce the risk of progression of mild disease to severe disease, and they might also hasten the recovery from mild COVID-19. However, this role is still evolving. We have mentioned this in our algorithm as one of the may do's, because as I said, we would require more data and more studies to buttress the claim of this being beneficial in mild COVID-19. There is no role of antibiotics, and monitoring is very crucial. Monitoring of vitals, BP pulse, respiration temperature, and especially saturation to see whether mild disease is progressing into moderate or severe disease. Right. So the answers to Mr. X's question would be that since he's having mild symptoms, he need not get any investigations done, including CT scan. And he is better off stopping his steroids, because steroids are a double-edged sword and they are clearly not indicated in patients of mild COVID-19. Right. Talking about management of moderate to severe disease, usually investigations, a battery of investigations are done, and we are going to talk about it. Management, it hinges on use of oxygen, supportive therapy, and some pharmacological therapy. Now, this pharmacological therapy, we are going to talk about it in a little bit details. So they can be classified into one of the four groups: antivirals, anti-inflammatory, anticoagulation, and supplements. So usually the investigations which are done, usually the workup which is done at presentation, they include a brief history taking, vitals, general physical examination, as well as assessment of the comorbidities which the patient might be having. Now, this clinical demographic factors are important, because we can also gauge the probability of mild disease progressing into severe disease, or the prognosis of a moderate to severe COVID-19 patients based on these factors. So it has been seen that advanced age, as well as some comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, chronic organ disease like cardiac, kidney, liver disease, pregnancy, and some addictions like smoking, they usually predict a poor prognosis. So we have to be mindful of that. Investigations, usually blood investigations like complete hemogram, KFT, LFT, inflammatory markers, they are done on the first day. And depending upon the condition of the patient and depending on the initial results, they may be repeated every 2 or 3 days. If the patient is admitted to the ICU, there might be a case for doing an ABG, or when you are suspecting an acid-base balance. ECG is usually done in all patients, depending on the comorbidities. So if the patient has a history of heart failure, we might want to get an echocardiography done. And if you're suspecting some other infections, for example, rainy season, you're your area is prone to malaria, dengue, you might want to get it ruled out as per your hospital protocol. If you are suspecting sepsis, blood, urine cultures, etc., has to be also sent. Now, one of the purposes of these investigations is that several of the investigation parameters like lymphopenia, elevated liver enzymes, elevated KFT, or LDH, CRP, ILCs increased, or elevated troponin D dimer, ferritin, they are known to be, again, poor prognostic markers for admitted COVID-19 patients. Now, all the patients who are admitted, they usually have a chest radiograph done at baseline. And depending on, again, the condition of the patient, the radiographs may be repeated. CT scan, however, is not indicated in all patients of COVID-19. Now, talking about CT scan, if you look at the standard indications of CT scan in COVID-19, they are usually used when we are suspecting COVID-19 in a patient whose RT-PCR, usually multiple times, they're coming negative. Or suppose the clinical history or the features, they do not match that of COVID-19. So suppose the patient has fever for a month, or hemoptysis. So you want to rule out something like tuberculosis. So you get a CT scan done. Or when the patient is there in the hospital and there is a sudden dip and you're suspecting something like pulmonary embolism. Or at the time of discharge, if you feel that the patient has some evidence of pulmonary sequelae, then you would like to get a CT scan done as well. But what we are seeing nowadays is one of the common indications for which CT scan has been done is severity assessment, not only in high-risk individuals, but in any patient who's there, who's being treated in the home, otherwise having mild COVID-19, they're also getting a routine CT scan done. It is to remember that this is not a standard indication. No studies, no guidelines, be it RSNA or any of the radiological society, or any of these studies for that matter, they say that CT scan done routinely in mild COVID-19 patients, they are helpful. So it's actually a waste of resources. It's also, you know, a procedure which is costly, and it's also a procedure where people might get inadvertently infected. So since it is not required routinely, we have to ration our CT scans accordingly. Now, once the patient is admitted, once you have started vital charting, SpO2 monitoring, and there is some aspects that we need to take care of. One is antibiotics, they are not routinely indicated in patients of COVID-19. Though it is very commonly prescribed, we see that patients of mild COVID-19 who are managed in the hospital, at their home, they're also getting routinely antibiotics. Patients who are admitted to COVID-19 hospital, sometimes they end up getting high generation antibiotics without any rhyme and reason. So that needs to be curtailed because of obvious reasons, because that would stoke the frequency of antimicrobial resistance, and it would render common antibiotics ineffective. What is important is symptomatic treatment with antipyretics and antitussives, and it's a good idea to keep the patient well hydrated, especially when he is having fever. Now we come on to the second case, Vignette. Mr. Y, a 65-year-old male patient with hypertension, diabetes, end-stage renal disease. He comes to the hospital with fever and shortness of breath for 5 days. He is diagnosed as COVID positive and his saturation is seen to be 92%. So as per the classification, he qualifies as moderate COVID-19. So the question is that which of the following should he be started immediately on? Remdesivir, tocilizumab, dexamethasone. Either one or all or more than one. So that's something we need to ponder on. Now, before we answer that, so a brief look at the available pharmacotherapy options. As I said, we have antivirals, which includes remdesivir, some drugs which are not commonly used like favipiravir, also convalescent plasma. Within anti-inflammatory, the most important is steroids, also tocilizumab, other IL-6 inhibitors. Anticoagulation usually includes agents like heparin or other NOACs. Supplements, vitamin C, zinc, vitamin D, they're commonly used, but as we are going to see that they are not of much benefit as far as studies are concerned. Talking about remdesivir, now we know that, you know, this has kind of become synonymous with being the treatment for COVID-19, but however, it is important to remember that remdesivir has got a very limited role as far as management of COVID-19 is concerned. Only one or two studies have shown any benefit of using remdesivir. And also in this study, the benefit has mostly with patients who are on low oxygen. So in other words, patients who are on high flow oxygen, HFNC, NIV, invasive mechanical ventilation, they actually do not benefit from remdesivir. So that is something which we want to keep in our mind. Also, before starting remdesivir, we need to look at the patient's EGFR, estimated GFR, and the LFT values. If they are deranged, then we have to be cautious before using remdesivir. Though there have been some reports of using remdesivir even with patients of ESRD, but we are usually a little cautious with that. The usual dose, I think we all know this, 200 first day, then 100 for 4 more days to complete a treatment of 5 days. Some may choose to extend it to 10 days depending on the patient's response. As I said, increased transaminases more than 5 times the upper limit of normal, as well as raised creatinine so that the GFR is less than 30, or the need for hemodialysis is said to be a contraindication for remdesivir, as well as children less than 12 years, as well as pregnancy and lactating women. They are the other contraindications for remdesivir. So if you remember, a patient, Mr. Y, had end-stage renal disease requiring maintenance hemodialysis. So according to this, he is ineligible for receiving remdesivir. Talking about convalescent plasma, initially there was a lot of hype about using convalescent plasma, and it was thought to be a panacea. But now the perception has been changing. Thanks to some trials which has happened around the globe. Now we have realized that the role of convalescent plasma is again very limited. Probably some patients who are early on in their disease, less than 7 days, and having, you know, moderate or early severe disease might benefit. So, you know, their use in our protocol has been relegated to one of the off-label use. If you're using convalescent plasma, we need to remember about cross-matching. We need to remember that we need to derive maximum benefit, we need the plasma which is laden with antibodies, and adverse reactions in the form of reactions are also common. The dose is usually 4 to 13 ml per kg, usually a single dose of 200 ml given over at least 2 hours, they are preferred. Talking about convalescent plasma, this is also a double-edged sword. There are potential adverse events and, you know, some theoretical risk associated with convalescent plasma. So one of the reasons why, again, it has fallen out of vogue, not being commonly used, because the risk-benefit ratio is clearly not in its favor. Talking about corticosteroids, this is again one of the most important treatment for moderate to severe COVID-19. So any patient of moderate to severe COVID-19, they should receive steroids, preferably dexamethasone, in the dose of 6 milligram per day, oral or IV, depending on whether the patient is able to take orally. And the duration is usually 10 days or till discharge, whichever is earlier. Some physicians, they prefer using steroids in other forms like methylprednisolone, prednisolone, which can also be done. Now the dose of dexamethasone is, if you would see, it's a low dose, it's 6 milligram. Now, there is no data to suggest that the dose of steroids, be dexamethasone or any other drug, can be modulated depending upon the patient's response. For example, a patient has been admitted with severe COVID-19. You start the patient on dexamethasone 6 milligram. On second, third day, you feel that the patient has not improved fully or the patient has deteriorated. Then no studies till date or no guidelines. Actually, they say that you need to increase the steroids. However, we see that sometimes it is done in clinical practice, but again, that has not much evidence to buttress it. Whenever using steroids, it is important to remember about side effects like hyperglycemia, hypernatremia. So we have to be vigilant about this. The other anti-inflammatory drug which is commonly used is the tocilizumab or the other IL-6 inhibitors or the other anti-IL-6 agents like sarilumab or celtuximab. Tocilizumab is clearly the most commonly used agent. Now, regarding tocilizumab, it is important to remember that there are two clear-cut indications as per CDC for use of tocilizumab. So one is recently hospitalized patients who have been admitted to ICU within the last 24 hours and who are requiring high degree of respiratory support. So HFNC or higher, HFNC, NIV, or invasive mechanical ventilation. So they are the ones that qualify as candidates for using tocilizumab. The second indication, this is again on the basis of the recovery trial. So this includes those patients who have been recently hospitalized, who are not in the ICU, but whose oxygen requirement, again, it is increasing progressively. So patients who have been admitted recently and who are actually deteriorating, and along with that, they have significantly increased markers of inflammation. So they are candidates for using tocilizumab. So if you are using tocilizumab, usually a single IV dose of 8 milligram per kg of actual body weight is used. And we commonly do not breach the upper limit of 800 milligram. There are some contraindications for anti-IL-6 therapy, namely thrombocytopenia, neutropenia, active infections like tuberculosis, or severe immunosuppressions. So we have to be a little careful before using tocilizumab, and it helps if you have a checklist where we see that whether the patient is fitting the indications and contraindications before administering this particular agent. Now, anticoagulation is another important pillar of COVID-19 management, because we know that COVID-19 is associated with increased prevalence of venous thrombolism. Now, previously, again, there was a lot of debate whether once a day dose or twice a daily dose of anticoagulation should be required, whether the dose should be modulated in moderate and severe COVID-19. But now it is, as per the recent evidence, it has been seen that there's not much role of increasing, decreasing the dose of anticoagulation. For moderate and severe COVID-19, we prefer prophylactic, that is once a day dose of low molecular weight heparin, and enoxaparin is again commonly required. There is no role of using different coagulation markers like D-dimer to again modify the dose of anticoagulation. So it should usually be a flat prophylactic dose of low molecular weight heparin, which should be used in moderate to severe COVID-19. If, however, the patient develops thromboembolism, DVT pulmonary embolism, then we should switch to double or therapeutic anticoagulation. Now, talking briefly about supplements, again, these are commonly used, vitamin C, vitamin D, zinc. A lot of people use it. Again, this is used probably because it is thought to be innocuous. No study talks about any meaningful outcome arising due to the use of these supplements. Right. So, in this table, I wanted to briefly summarize the treatment strategies required for moderate and severe disease. So, what I want you to do is I want you to concentrate on the right-sided right column practice. And here I would also try to discuss a little bit about the other agents which I have not covered, like azithromycin, lopinavir, etc. So within antivirals, as I said, remdesivir and convalescent plasma, they have some role, but again, they are not to be thought as panaceas. Other antivirals like hydroxychloroquine, azithromycin, ivermectin, other antiretroviral drugs, they have not shown any benefit, and they have now kind of fallen out of favor. Within anti-inflammatory agents, again, I want you to look at the right, the column on the right. So within anti-inflammatory agents, again, dexamethasone is preferred, and it is used in all patients of moderate to severe COVID disease. Tocilizumab, as I said, they have two clear-cut indications. One is for patients who are in the ICU, HFNC or above, within 24 to 48 hours of admission, and patients who are not in the ICU, but who are deteriorating on oxygen, they are candidates for tocilizumab. Regarding anticoagulation, so one thing if you want to remember is low-dose prophylactic anticoagulation is preferred. Therapeutic dose is reserved only for established thromboembolism. Supplements, again, thought to be innocuous, not much benefit, not much evidence in its favor. So the answer to the case Signet 2, that which of the following should be started immediately for Mr. X. So remdesivir, because should not be used because the patient had ESRD. Tocilizumab, because the patient has been recently admitted, and there is no suggestion that the patient is deteriorating or the patient is requiring HFNC or higher forms of respiratory support. So tocilizumab should not be used in case. Since he is moderate COVID-19, he should receive dexamethasone. It should be started as soon as possible. Right. So once a patient is there, say in ward or in HDU, you know, the patient should again be routinely monitored. So we should look at his SpO2 FiO2 ratio again, and the other vital parameters. And if any of these parameters they deteriorate, then the patient should ideally be shifted to the ICU for further management. Now, so this is a case vignette about one such patient who deteriorated, and let's see how this case goes. So this is about Mrs. Z, a 40-year-old female patient who had some comorbidities, hypertension, diabetes, and she has been admitted with a diagnosis of severe COVID-19. Now, initially she was managing on 4 liters of per minute. On day 2, it is noticed that she was having increasing breathlessness, and she had to be moved from nasal prong to face mask to NRBM to HFNC. So what would you want to do in this particular case? Would you like to start tocilizumab? Would you like to increase the dose of steroids? Or would you like to repeat the investigations, get a chest X-ray or a CT scan done? Right. So in this case, what happened was a chest X-ray was done, and the patient was seen to have a pneumothorax on the left side, right? Which was drained, and the patient became better. So the point behind this case vignette is that when we are treating COVID-19, a critically ill patient, we should remember the basic tenets of practicing medicine. A patient is deteriorating. It should not be that we should be having only COVID-19 management in our mind. We should also be looking out. We should also be in the watch out for other complications, which we see in other critically ill patients as well. Right. So talking about complications, all the patients who are being managed in the ward or ICU, they should be routinely screened for catheter-related bloodstream infections clinically. And if required, blood culture should be advised. We should emphasize on changing the posture of the patient in the bed repeatedly so as to prevent pressure ulcers. Use PPIs and other measures to prevent stress ulcers and chance of GI bleeding. We should also be using antimicrobials sparingly, only when the indications arises, to prevent again the development of antimicrobial resistance. If you're using some drugs, it is also important that we look out for the development of adverse drug effects. So briefly to summarize, in mild, moderate, and severe disease. So in mild disease, be it antivirals, anti-inflammatory, anticoagulations, supplements, they are not much required. There might be a scope for inhaled budesonide, but again, this evidence is evolving. So we should be a little vigilant about this. Regarding moderate disease, there is a role for using remdesivir if the patient is on low flow oxygen. All cases of moderate disease should receive steroids. Tocilizumab again only when there is one of the two indications which I talked about. And anticoagulation should be given in prophylactic dose to all patients of moderate disease. Ditto for severe or critically ill patients. Here, however, the important difference being that remdesivir for people who are not on low flow oxygen, remdesivir is out. Steroids and anticoagulations, again, they are the pillars of management. Tocilizumab, again, for one of the two indications. And supplements, they are again not shown to have any benefits even in this group of patients. So that is more or less what I have to say. So these are my take home messages. So so I would like to emphasize that any patient of COVID-19, we should try to classify COVID-19, mild, moderate, severe, because the algorithm moves according to that. And we should be careful about the treatment algorithm, because it's not that every COVID-19 patient should be treated with steroids or remdesivir or anticoagulation. We should be mindful of the indications. If the patient qualifies for a particular drug, then and only then should we try to use that particular drug in that particular patient. Steroids and anticoagulations, they are again the sheath anchor, the most important treatment as far as moderate and severe COVID-19 is concerned. Remdesivir and tocilizumab, they have got selected role only in few indications of using remdesivir and tocilizumab. And supplements are commonly used, they do not have much role. Now, oxygen and other supportive therapy, they are of paramount importance, and I think we have this next talk on this. So that is all I have to say. Thank you for your patient listening.